added, quote, "We cannot allow ourselves to be unprepared again." City News time is 10:01. It's time for traffic and weather together on the ones. Here's Eva Fragiscados.
Good morning. It's been a busy drive on the eastbound 401 from approaching Trafalgar to east of Mississauga Road. On the westbound side of the 401, also have delays from Mavis to Mississauga Road. The 401 in both directions through Cambridge towards Drumbo and Woodstock. It's moving quite well at this time. East and westbound 78, no major delays through there right now. It looks like it's moving quite well through the Kitchener area. 78 to at Navziger, minor delays at that intersection, and then after that moves pretty well. Northbound Highway 6 south, it's still slow from north of Leslie to approaching the 401. Highway 24, Highway 8 towards the 401. That still seems to be moving quite well at this time. I'm not spotting any delays or problems along Highway 85 through St. Jacobs through Waterloo. Highway 86 also moving well through Elmira and through the Macton area. Line 86 at Floridale Road still have that ongoing construction through there. Very minor delay. And we also have construction in Kitchener if you are on Charles Street at Gockle Street, partially closed off for road work. Weber Street from Queen Street to Frederick, also partially closed off for utility work. Now with the check on the forecast, here's John Wilson.
Another tough system coming through as the warm air just can't win this battle because we're so cold now. Sunny and 3 today, but minus 7 overnight. As that system comes into minus 7 air, it has warm air coming in aloft. That means light snow changes quickly to freezing rain tomorrow morning, and maybe several hours of it before that minus 7 can get to 0. After that, it's rain and 3, but before that, it's trouble. Then Thursday, showers turn back to flurries as we spike quickly at 12 in the morning and then drop sharply. 0 again Friday. Today's high 3.
And right now outside of our studio, a mainly sunny sky, minus 6, a wind chill of minus 11. Ahead of today's talks, Turkey's president told Ukrainian and Russian negotiators in Istanbul they have a historic responsibility to stop the fighting. Those talks are now over. City's Irene Preklet joins us with more.
Turkey's foreign minister says Russian and Ukrainian negotiators have reached a consensus and common understanding on some issues, adding that a meeting between the Russian and Ukrainian leaders was also on the agenda, but did not give a time frame. Russia's deputy minister saying today that Moscow has decided to fundamentally cut back operations near the capital and Chernihiv. The mayor of that city says it has already paid a heavy price with hundreds dead, hundreds of others hurt, and a city in ruins.
Striking against civilians, our city has been under sustained attack from mortar shells and from mortar shelling and from airstrikes. The mortars are striking from a long distance.
Ukraine's military says it has noted withdrawals around the two cities. Irene Preklet, City News.
City News 570 is CKGL AM Kitchener. You can download the City News 570 app at kitchener.citynews.ca. News next at 10:30. I'm Luke Schultz, City News.
If knowledge is power, consider this show your Sword of Grayskull. Welcome to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570, and welcome in to our viewers now joining us on Rogers TV. Channel 20. Well, more than 9,000 public sector employees in Waterloo Region earned themselves a place on the Sunshine List with salaries of $100,000 a year or more in the year 2021. There are more than 244,000 people on the list who made more than six figures last year, up from approximately 205,000 in 2020, a difference of about 19%. Here to talk more about it with us right now is Marvin Ryder, is an assistant professor in the DeGroot School of Business at McMaster University. Marvin, thanks for joining us.
Glad to be with you today.
So let's just do a little bit of background here. How did this list first come to be? We've been with it, I think, for about 25 years now, haven't we?
That's correct. So the list materialized when Mike Harris was Premier of Ontario. It was a simple idea. Let's have more transparency as to what people are getting paid. And so in 1996, this is now the 26th year of the list, but 25 years ago, roughly, the list was published, and it was an arbitrary number, $100,000. It just seemed like a nice cutoff point. Anyone below that was just five figures. This was the crossover to six figures. That first list in 1996, 4,576 names. Again, to put that in context, you noted that in your region alone, nearly 9,000 people are on the list. So it was a very small cut at things. Today, as you pointed out again, 244,390 names. Collectively, they equal $30 billion worth of salaries. Having said that to you, the vast majority of them are relatively close to the cutoff. What do I mean by that? 47% of the list, almost half, are within $10,000 of the cutoff. Another 40% if you go up to $150,000. And then if you go at the extreme end, less than 1.3% of the people on the list earn $250,000 or more. But nonetheless, it's a big, big list that's been around for a long time.
And there's been calls over the years to maybe get rid of it. But I think if we got rid of it now, that might, you know, people would cry that the government is being less transparent. So it's, right. It's very difficult to get rid of it now, I think, isn't it?
It is. So the more, can I call it a reasonable call, would be to say, well, if 100,000 was the right number in 1996, why don't we inflation adjust that number? Because if that was the cutoff, again, with nearly 250,000 names on the list, other than a lot of interesting trivia, what really is the value of the list? But if we said, well, really what we were trying to do was to expose the most senior salaries, the largest salaries, so that people could see those, what if we inflation adjusted? Now, I don't happen to have that number just as I'm sitting here, but 25 years of inflation, say running around 2%, it isn't that hard to imagine that the cutoff might be $150,000, $160,000, $175,000, and you would dramatically reduce the size of the list. Now, having said that to you, the other thing that seems to happen, especially at this time of the year, is that news agencies focus not on the totality of the list or those people just close to the cutoff, mm-hmm. but instead our eye immediately goes to the very top of the list. And I don't know if this shocks people or not, but there are people who are employed by the government of Ontario who are paid or more than $1 million a year. There aren't many of them. Mm-hmm. I think there's a total of four. Almost all of those work with Hydro One or Ontario Power Generation. Senior hospital administrators aren't yet at $1 million, but they are getting closer. I think the top one is Dr. Kevin Smith, who's the CEO at the University Health Network, and I think he's at around $850,000 to $900,000. So maybe the value is really, as the media have done, to focus at the top of the list rather than the totality.
Yeah, I was looking at the list. The top four names are all for Ontario Power Generation. I remember Ford, when he got elected, promised to reel in some of those salaries, but those salaries at Ontario Power Generation continued to go up.
Well, again, I'm going to say yes and no to that. You're right. They do continue to go up. Inflation always marches forward. But you may or may not remember that the top man back when Doug Ford got elected, I think, was earning closer to $5 million. That person was then terminated, and there was a big severance paid out.
Right.
And so the idea was that the replacement people, you're not coming in at what the last guy earned. You're going to come in at something more reasonable. Again, I say this out loud, and I realize people listening will say $1.5 million isn't reasonable, but if the previous person was earning $5 million or $6 million, $1.5 is a significant reduction.
All right, that's a point I actually hadn't thought of. Thanks a lot. We've mentioned inflation a couple of times. Should this be indexed to inflation, in your opinion?
Well, it goes back to what is the point of the list. If the point of the list was simply to shine a spotlight on top earners so that there would be transparency, then I don't think it really makes any difference. There are too many names now for people to really fully comprehend. I will admit I am on the list. I have been on the list for probably a decade or more, mm-hmm. and my neighbors in the area love to search my name and find my pay, and sometimes they'll even stop me when I'm mowing my lawn to say, hey, I know what you earned last year. I say, funny, I don't know what you earned at all, but that's the consequence of being on the public payroll. So I'm not sure if the idea was simply to rein in. And by the way, here's another funny thing. It's had the opposite effect. Mike, let's suppose I'm the board at one of the hospitals in the Kitchener area, and I say, I like what you've got here. Why don't you become the next CEO of the hospital? I'm going to pay you $300,000 a year. And initially you might say, wow, I'm very flattered that I'm going to come. Let me just check the sunshine list to see what people were earning before. Whoa, wait a minute. My predecessor was earning $500,000. No, I'm not going to take the job for $300,000. I want more. So, in fact, everyone who's employed at that highest level knows what their other colleagues are being paid, and it's actually caused, again, more inflation in those wages. No one can get a deal these days because they know exactly what their comparators are all earning.
That is a point I hadn't thought about either, Marvin. Thanks very much for joining us today.
Glad to be with you.
Marvin Ryder is an assistant professor in the DeGroote School of Business at McMaster University. Ontario released last week its annual list of what's called the Sunshine List. It's been coming out every year since, I believe, 1995 or 1996, a list of all public sector employees in Ontario who make more than $100,000 a year. If you have thoughts on this, of course, I always love to take your phone calls. 519-570-2545, out of town, 1-800-570-5715, and star 570. 244,000 public sector employees on this list, 244,000 making more than $100,000 a year. Now, in 2020, that number was 205,000. And many people have called for this list to be indexed to inflation. 2 points on that. First of all, the average Ontarian, I Googled this morning, the average Ontarian makes about, where is it here? $52,260 a year. That's average. And this Sunshine List is indexed to 100,000. So 100,000, even today, even 25, 26 years after we started publishing the Sunshine List, $100,000 a year is still a nice chunk of change. It's almost double what the average person makes. So yeah, $52,260. Now, the other thing I always like to look at is, you know, this list continues to grow every year with the number of names on it. You know, 244,000 in 2021, 205,000 in 2020. So we talk about this list being indexed to inflation. And inflation is, and it's, the numbers vary. It depends on who you listen to, and it's somewhere, they tell you anyway, it's somewhere between 3% and 5%. My father worked in finance for 35 years, and he told me that the real inflation rate is always 2 or 3% higher than what they're telling you. But regardless, whatever the inflation rate is, the list grew by 19%. So even if the Sunshine List was indexed to inflation every year, the list would still grow. The list grows faster than the rate of inflation. So indexing it to inflation would still mean the list would grow every year by probably 10%, 8, 9, 10% at least. Ontario's Sunshine List is out. In Waterloo Region, 9,000 public sector employees made the list of over 100,000 in 2021. Now, in Waterloo Region, maybe you're curious. Here are some of the names on the top 10 list. The top name in Waterloo Region is Robert Myers. He is the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics, $512,000 a year. We have an employee for the University of Waterloo. He retired last June, making $473,000. Ronald Gagnon from Grand River Hospital, $457,000. John Tibbetts from from Conestoga College, president of Conestoga College, $409,000, almost $410,000. Ian Klugman from Communitech, $377,000. Police Chief Brian Larkin, a lot of people are interested in his salary, 375 300,000, just a shade over 375. There are a few other names on the list. You can check them out. This is all readily available. You can search by name if you want. But yeah, so that's the question I want to ask you. Should the Sunshine List be indexed to inflation? I'm not so quick to jump to that conclusion for reasons I just mentioned. 519-570-2545, out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570. This is the Mike Farwell Show with me, producer Polly, filling in on City News 570 and Rogers Television.
It's a give and take. Mike gives you a chance to call, and we get to hear your take. Call 519-570-2545 or 1-800-570-5715. More of the Mike Farwell Show after this. Waterloo region a better place. It's still a work in progress. This is the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
Today, as you pointed out again, 244,390 names. Collectively, they equal $30 billion worth of salaries. Having said that to you, the vast majority of them are relatively close to the cutoff. What do I mean by that? 47% of the list, almost half, are within $10,000 of the cutoff. Another 40% if you go up to $150,000.
Marvin Ryder is an assistant professor in the DeGroote School of Business at McMaster University. Joined us a few moments ago to talk about the annual Sunshine List, which came out. It comes out every year here in Ontario and other provinces and other jurisdictions across North America have similar lists as well. This is not just unique to Ontario, but the Ontario Sunshine List came out last week, and more than 9,300 Waterloo Region public sector workers made the $100,000 threshold of the Sunshine List. 519-570-2545, out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570 hands free. The question has always been raised, should this be indexed to inflation? Of course, because $100,000 in 1996 was a lot less money, or a lot more money, I guess, relative than it is now. My opinion on this, at least for the time being, is it should not be indexed to inflation, because $100,000 a year is still almost double what the average Ontarian makes. And even if the list were indexed to inflation, the list would still grow, a 19% increase from the list 2020 versus 2021, 19%. And inflation, whatever inflation is, depending on who you listen to, it's not 19%. It's probably, 6-7%. Those numbers come out every month, the inflation rate year over year, but the list would still grow. So that's what I always look at. Our guest, Marvin Ryder from McMaster University, brought up an interesting point that I actually haven't thought of. And he was saying that this Sunshine List that comes out every year, again, a divulgence of public sector salaries over 100,000. In kind of a roundabout way, the Sunshine List may actually, in a way, increase public sector salaries. Because if you're taking a high-level public sector job, paying more than $100,000 a year, you can just look at the list. In negotiating your salary, you can take a look at what your colleagues would be making, and you can even take a look at what your predecessor would have been making. And you're offering me $300,000 a year, but I can see on this Sunshine List that my predecessor was making $500,000 a year. So you're undercutting me a little bit. So there's no kind of secret power to bargain your salary anymore. So that I had not thought of that. The possibility that the Sunshine List itself may actually be increasing salaries, because everybody's salary is out there. You know what everybody's making. I should deserve equal pay for equal work. Andre, go ahead.
Yes, hi, Paulie. thank you for sharing that list from your radio station. It's blowing my mind, and I understand a little bit more why there's no room for me in Kitchener-Waterloo, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But I'm very proud of Kitchener-Waterloo for being that. Considering the list, Commissioner Brian Larkin, I'm blown up by that number, but he does deserve it because I think he's one of the best commissioner.
It's a tough job. It's a tough job, for sure.
Studying and all that stuff, right? The technician and all that, they deserve. I understand that. Like, if we had, Stephen Hopkins over here, and, he would earn the big bucks because he's worth the big bucks. So I understand that. But like you said, that all these salaries equal to how many billion, that just blows my mind of how much inflation is.
$36 billion make up the entire list, according to our guest. Yeah.
Like, Paulie, I was never learned to count that much when I was little.
Yeah.
But you have a good day, Paul.
Thanks, Andre. You know, that's one thing, too, when it comes to, government spending. And, you hear numbers thrown out all the time. Canada's going to devote, $26 million to this, that, or whatever. How many of us have ever even in a position to even know what $26 million looks like? It's just so, the average person can't even relate to it. And I think that's why, when some of these government expense reports come out and you hear that somebody was treated to a dinner at the taxpayer's expense, $85 a plate for food, and the orange juice cost $8.50. See, we can all Actually, maybe even more than that. $8.50 seems to be kind of the going rate for a glass of orange juice these days. But let's say a $25 glass of orange juice. You hear that, oh, well, a $25 glass of orange juice. People can relate to that. And so people get more upset over the really little things because it's something we can relate to. We can't relate to hundreds of billions of dollars when we hear, but it's the number is so big that we can't even comprehend it. By the way, the top name on the Sunshine List is Kenneth Hartwick. He is president and executive officer of Ontario Power Generation. Actually, the top four names on the list this year are from Ontario Power Generation. He made $1.6 million. He made $1.2 million in 2020. That's up 35%. But as our guest pointed out, his predecessor was making a lot more than that. So maybe you can make the argument that Doug Ford did cut back on some of those salaries at Ontario Power Generation. Bruce, go ahead.
Hey, Paul, I'm glad you brought that up because I was going to bring that up. I remember when Ford first took over, the head of the power generation, I believe he was making $5 million. And he was due a $10 million bonus that year, and the corporation was losing money, so that's ridiculous. I just did a couple of quick calculations. First of all, I'm surprised that the average person is making whatever you said, 52, 50 or something like that.
That's according to Google, so take that for what you need.
Yeah, I thought it was around 40, 44.
All right.
Anyway, if you take, let's deal with some easy figures. You take $50,000, and you get you won't get it, but you get a 5% raise, so now you're up to $52,500. Mm-hmm. If the $100,000 person got the same raise, he's up to $105,000. So in the first year, he's making $50,000 more than you. In the second year, now he's making $52,500 more than you, and it keeps going up. You know what I mean? It keeps going up
right.
And up. So even if you get the same raise, you're still falling behind. Brian Larkin, is he worth it? I don't know. That's questionable, but I would give it to him. But when you said that guy was a head of physics somewhere or something?
Yeah, the head of the Perimeter Institute, Robert Myers, $512,000 a year.
You know, I love the Big Bang Theory, but we don't need to know anything more about physics, I don't think. Like, that is absolutely ludicrous. I can't believe that somebody would be making that much money. You know, if you make $500,000 and you're working for a private company and that company's making profit, all the power to you.
Mm-hmm.
Give you money, give you bonuses. But it boggles my mind some of the names you put out there, especially the physics guy. That is too much.
Yeah, great. Thanks for the call, Bruce. Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say that we don't need physics. I don't know anything about physics. So I'm not in the position to say, we don't need that. But everybody is an expert in something, and that's the beautiful thing about the world we live in. News is next, and then more of the Mike Farwell Show with myself, producer Pauly, filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
Look at that. Somebody found Mike Farwell's off switch. He's off for a few minutes. But the Mike Farwell Show returns after this on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
This hour.
number one for breaking news, traffic, and weather. This is City News 570, everywhere.
It's 10:30 outside of our studio, mainly sunny, minus 5, a wind chill of minus 11. I'm Luke Schultz with the City News 570 top story. Ontario seeking to recruit more nurses in underserved communities, permanently boost the pay of personal support workers, and maintain a stockpile of personal protective equipment. The measures are some of the items in what the province is calling a plan to stay open, which aims to ensure Ontario is better equipped to respond to another health crisis. The legislation would also require annual reporting on supplies of personal protective equipment and require the province to have a provincial emergency plan that's updated every 5 years. Additionally, the government also announcing $81 million over 2 years to extend a program in which nursing graduates can receive full tuition reimbursement in exchange for committing to practice in an underserved community for 2 years. Canada has issued at least 11 greenhouse gas emission plans and set 9 emission targets since 1988 and never met a single goal. But Environment Minister Stephen Guilbeault insists the new emissions plan he's tabling in Parliament this morning is different. He says this one is the first to provide a roadmap to actually meet a climate target, projecting the oil and gas industry will need to cut emissions by 40% from current levels by 2030. Deputy Russian Defense Minister Alexander Fomin says Moscow is cutting back military operations near Kyiv and Chernihiv to, quote, increase mutual trust in talks in Istanbul. It appears to be the first major concession in the Russians have made since launching their invasion of Ukraine more than a month ago. Ukraine's military says it had noted withdrawals around the two cities, but the Pentagon hasn't corroborated those reports. Follow City News 570 on Twitter at City News KIT. News next at 11 o'clock. I'm Luke Schultz, City News.
He's driving the motorcycle, and we're just sitting in the sidecar, along for the ride. We return to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570 and Rogers TV. Producer Polly in with you till noon today. Well, Saturday afternoon, my wife and I are out at the hardware store, and we get talking to one of the employees there, and she mentions that there's these historic walking tours of Waterloo Region. I'm like, this is right up my alley. I didn't know this was happening here in Kitchener, Waterloo, because whenever I go to a new city, I always like to try to take some sort of a tour, whether it's a walking tour or a double-decker guided bus tour or whatever. I just like to see the city that I'm in. But you don't think really to be really, maybe that's a kind of a tourist in your own town sort of a thing. The things to do in your own town tend to slip your mind sometimes, at least it does with me. So I was really excited when I found out that there's these walking tours that you can do in Kitchener-Waterloo, and I'm really excited to be joined by Juanita Metzger, is owner and operator of Straw Walking Tours. Juanita, welcome to the show.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
So how long have you been doing this?
Well, Straw Walking Tours started in 2020, in fact. And I was in the process of starting and launching the business prior to the pandemic, of course. Mm-hmm. And then everything sort of slowed to a halt, and I put all my launch plans on hold. But later in late summer, early fall of 2020, when things started to reopen, and it looked like nobody was traveling anywhere anytime soon, it seemed like it seemed like an idea to launch anyway, because there was so much emphasis on supporting local and exploring local, and it seemed like a great idea for an outdoor activity that people could do together in small groups during the early days of the pandemic. And people really felt like they had an opportunity to travel when we weren't going anywhere. And it was a great opportunity to learn something about their own community and explore local.
So what got you interested in this? Were you always interested in the history and the history of Waterloo Region?
I've been more a walker and an engager rather than a history-focused person. And I used to lead Jane's Walks in the past and coordinated Jane's Walks events in Waterloo Region for a number of years. And in my past work as a community development worker, I would work with neighborhoods a lot. And in order to get to know them and understand what kinds of things a neighborhood wanted to work on and maybe some challenges that they were experiencing, I would say, take me on a walk in your neighborhood. Show me around. So it really became this way of engaging people in conversations, in learning about where they lived. And you know, always after Jane's Walks and these neighborhood walks, people would just express how their perspective maybe shifted or changed because of what they learned or what they didn't realize they already knew about their own community. And walking just seems to really help people develop a connection to where they live. And when you mix in some history and stories about people and places in our own community, the light really goes on for people about it being maybe a more interesting place than they hadn't realized.
Are these tours guided?
They are guided. They are all guided. And so I lead a couple myself, and then there are six other guides who also lead a walking tour. And each one of the guides has researched and developed and designed the walk that they lead. And so a group always gets the best guide for the walking tour that they choose. So there's everything from Mount Hope Cemetery, the murals and the, you know, a fabulous outdoor gallery in downtown Kitchener. There's walks about different times in history. You know, Kitchener and the rest of the world experienced a pandemic over 100 years ago in 1918. And there's a walk about how the pandemic affected Kitchener and specifically in 1918. There's walks about Kitchener and the First World War at a time when it was still called Berlin. Mm-hmm. And that was the time period when it actually changed its name. There's a Black History focused walk. There's a walk in Waterloo. A real a range of topics to engage any interest.
When do these tours run, or they just run when, you know, you get enough people to sign up for one of them?
Right. So in the past 2 years, I had been offering private groups only because it was a way for people to feel comfortable in small groups and being outdoors. But this year, I've started adding public dates where people can sign up as individuals or in pairs, and they don't need a large group to book a tour. So I do have dates that are throughout April and May, some of the walking tours coming up, including a blues walking tour coming up this Saturday, April 2nd. Mm-hmm. And then throughout the month of April, there's a few others as well. And then in May, there's a walking tour in St. Jacobs that starts up in mid-May, and those dates are available on the Stroll Walking Tours website.
Could weather cancel a tour, or is it rain or shine?
We walk rain or shine, mm-hmm. Except if there is an extreme weather advisory,
right,
or a thunderstorm or a torrential downpour. We want everybody to have a positive experience, and horrendous weather doesn't really help with that. But we do go out in rain and warmer weather, and in February, actually, we launched the Black History Walk during Black History Month.
Of course.
And we did 6 walking tours in February. So, yeah, we encourage people to dress for the weather, which means, you know, appropriate clothing. It might mean an umbrella and a rain jacket, but it's a great opportunity to be outdoors.
Now, most of these tours, it looks like, are in Kitchener. There's a couple in there's one in St. Jacobs. Any plans to add more tours?
Yes, of course. There's also one in Waterloo, and plans are to add a walk or two in Cambridge. So that usually takes a bit of time to develop the right topic and the guide and the route. So definitely in development, we want to make sure that we're being able to explore across the whole region.
Do you have a favorite tour of all the ones that you're currently offering?
That's like picking a favorite child. I think I have different favorites for different reasons. I really love the pandemic walking tour, mm-hmm. partly because it's something that happened 100 years ago, so not in our lifetime. And the kinds of parallels and echoes that we see in the current pandemic that we're experiencing has been really fascinating to learn about. And then to walk through our community and to see where families lived who maybe experienced, deaths in their family. The fact that the Dare Cookie family, their house, their family home is on Weber Street, mm-hmm. and their family was affected by several deaths in their family. And those family members are also buried in the Mount Hope Cemetery, which is also on our cemetery walking tour. So the pandemic one is fascinating just because it's so current and topical. The Mount Hope Cemetery one is also a favorite, just because the guide is such an amazing storyteller and really weaves together the history of Kitchener and previously Berlin with a lot of the familiar names and dates that we see in the cemetery. And so we're able to see how the lives of people from, 100 years ago contributed to the city that we know today, maybe through architecture or municipal development or arts and culture. So he really does bring to life, names that are carved in stone. I really also like the Waterloo Walk because mm-hmm. the guides are really great at identifying history of Waterloo that we don't see anymore because maybe the buildings aren't there anymore. And so they're also able to recreate aspects of history that are harder for us to access because we don't visibly have a reference to see them in our daily life. They're all fascinating.
What about this transportation one? Talks about the history of transportation in the Kitchener.
Yeah, that's also fascinating because it's something that we take for granted that our cities are planned for us to be able to get around. And it's interesting to think about how cities evolved in order to accommodate the evolution of transportation. And as we just went through a major public construction of our LRT, the guide, Todd Bowman, he looks at other iterations of that happened in the past. A train that connected Preston to Berlin. And the fact that we could travel several times a day between Kitchener and Toronto on the Grand Trunk Railway, looking at how they cleared the snow in the early days before we had modern snow removal equipment, to think of how, after a snowfall, how would they have cleared King Street? Looking at the various forms of transportation that have taken place and how streets evolved, and it's fascinating.
How long are these? Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say it's fascinating to look at the things that are so familiar and maybe ordinary to us, but to think about how they took shape over a period of time.
How long are each of these tours on average?
The majority of them are 90 minutes long, and some of them are slightly shorter at about 75 minutes long.
Well, this is really cool what you're doing, Juanita. And when I heard about these tours, I just had to get you on. So thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you. And I look forward to hosting you on a walk soon.
Oh, yeah. I my wife and I will definitely be there for sure. By the way, where can people find out more?
Find out more at strollwalkingtours.com. And sign up for the newsletter, because that's where I always announce first any new dates for walking tours that we have available. And there is a calendar on a page on the website, the walking tours page. There's a calendar that has all the upcoming public dates, and people can also book private groups as well.
All right, Juanita, thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much.
Juanita Metzger is owner and operator of Stroll Walking Tours. And you could, I don't know, maybe be a tourist in your own city. I don't know. You know, you don't think about the things, because I often think, you know, why would anybody come here? But I live here every day, right? So I take some of the things and the history in this region for granted. But this really is a neat idea. When I go to a different city, I always try to go on some sort of a tour. And all of these tours look really interesting. The website, again, strollwalkingtours.com, strollwalkingtours.com, or you can call them 519-242-WALK, 519-242-9255. And they have, how many are on here? 13, 12, 13, 14. It really looks interesting. So yeah, I'm going to be, my wife and I no doubt will be on some of these tours. This is the Mike Farwell Show with producer Paul filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
You've got something to say. Now it's time to say it on the Mike Farwell Show. Call 519-570-2545 or 1-800-570-5715. This hour. take. This is the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
Walking just seems to really help people develop a connection to where they live. And when you mix in some history and stories about people and places in our own community, the light really goes on for people about it being maybe a more interesting place than they had realized.
Juanita Metzger is owner and operator of Stroll Walking Tours, joined us a few moments ago to talk about these, again, as the name suggests, walking to guided walking tours too, which is really neat. I always am a little disappointed when I look into a tour of some sort, a walking tour, and it's self-guided. I really like having the tour guide in on a tour. So these are guided walking tours. Very cool. Rush, go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, Polly. I enjoy doing these tours also when I go to a different city. Mm-hmm. I got to say, at my initial take on this one, I was like, there's not enough interesting things around KW to want to. But then when she started explaining them and the themed aspect of it,
yeah,
I actually think they'd be quite interesting. So I'm gonna keep my eyes open. I'll sign up for her newsletter and keep my eyes open. And I think my wife and I would actually enjoy checking one out too. So thanks for having her on.
Appreciate it. No problem. Yeah. And so I heard about this on Saturday afternoon. So people are going to get sick of me mentioning this. The movie, the Rock This Town movie, my wife and I went to go see it, The Princess Twin, on Saturday afternoon. And one of the things they mention in the film is that famous story of the Guess Who song, American Woman, which was not only written in Kitchener, but was written in the middle of a concert in what, well, it's now Glenbrier Home Hardware. It was, at the time, a curling club. And the Guess Who were playing there one night. I won't go into the details of why they were playing Kitchener-Waterloo at that point. I want you to go see the movie, Rock This Town. They explain it. But my wife and I were inspired after going to see that film. So we drove up and down University Avenue where some of these concerts took place, and we stopped in at Glenbrier Home Hardware, and we got talking to one of the employees there, and she told us about this lady who started up these stroll walking tours. And we're like, that sounds really interesting. And my wife was like, there's content for your show. The next time you fill in, you got to get them on. So that's honestly how it happened. So really neat idea. Grant, go ahead.
It's kind of unique that you brought this up, because the last time I saw Burton Cummings, he mentioned that we played location where the Home Hardware was.
Right, Glenbrier Home Hardware was at that time a curling club.
Yeah, kind of neat to hear that really this song was written there.
Yeah, yeah. In the middle of a guitar string broke, and they had to come up with a riff to kind of get the strings all tuned again, and they put lyrics to the riff, and there came American Woman.
Yeah, that's kind of neat. And I saw Randy Bachman a number of years ago, and he did a tour on how, and he explained of how he wrote these songs,
mm-hmm.
which was kind of neat.
Right.
Neat, too.
Cool. Thanks for the call, Grant. Yeah, it's a lot of history in this region, and again, living here, you kind of let it pass you by sometimes. And so of all the tours on the website, there's, 3, 6, 9, 12, there's like 13 or 14 tours on this website, strollwalkingtours.com. Each is provided, according to our guest, Juanita Metzger, by a different tour guide who is passionate about that exact tour, and they developed themselves. So that is a really neat thing, too, because I know sometimes what happens with some of the tours that I've gone on in different cities. And, sometimes you'll get a tour guide who almost doesn't even care. Yeah, over on the left-hand side, that's a historic building. And over on the right. And I went on a tour once. I think it was in Chicago, where the tour guide spent half the tour, it seemed, pointing out, oh, yeah, there's where I grew up. There's where my best friend lived on that street over there. I don't care. Tell me about the city. So, yeah, each one of the tour guides is very passionate about that specific tour. So, again, really cool sounding idea. I'm going to check it out myself, strollwalkingtours.com. Or if you don't have the old internets, 519-242-WALK, 519-242-9255. This is the Mike Farwell Show with producer Polly filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
CKGL AM Kitchener.
Broadcasting live from the boardwalk.
Breaking news, traffic, and weather.
When you need to know, keep it on City News 570.
This hour of the Mike Farwell Show is...
For breaking news, traffic, and weather. This is City News 570, everywhere.
It is 11 o'clock, partly sunny, minus 5, and the wind chill is minus 11. We are also now under a special weather statement for the risk of freezing rain and ice pellets tomorrow morning and afternoon. Good morning, I'm Paul McPhee with the City News 570 top story. The Ford government is unveiling a new plan to prepare for future health emergencies. City's Richard Southern reports.
The government announcing new legislation today. It's calling it a plan to stay open. It's basically an initiative to make sure the province is better equipped to respond to any new healthcare crisis. Health Minister Christine Elliott.
Looking back, the most important lesson we've learned is that we cannot allow ourselves to be unprepared again.
This new plan would require annual reporting on supplies of personal protective equipment and require the province to have a provincial emergency plan that's updated every 5 years. The government also announcing $81 million over 2 years to expand a program in which nurse graduates can receive their full tuition back in exchange for practicing in an underserved community for 2 years. Also included in this legislation is a permanent pay raise for PSW, something that was previously announced. Richard Southern, City News.
City News time, 11:01. Time for traffic and weather together on the ones. Here's Eva Fragiscados.
Good morning. If you are eastbound on the 401, you're going to find everything moving quite well through the Cambridge area. But then eastbound 401, just east of Highway 25, we've got the right lane blocked off by MTO crews. It appears we've got a coyote on the highway. So eastbound 401, just east of Highway 25, the right lane is blocked as well as the right shoulder by crews. Again, that's because of a coyote on the highway. Eastbound 401, as a result, it's quite slow going from Highway 25 to just east of it where we've got the right lane and right shoulder still blocked. Farther along, eastbound 401 slows down again from about, looks like now from the 407 to east of Mississauga Road. Westbound on the 401, minor delays through Mavis. And if you're westbound on the 401 from Cambridge towards the Woodstock area, no delays or problems there. 78 through Kitchener, Waterloo, through the New Hamburg area, moving quite well. And it looks like eastbound Highway 7 towards Guelph is also in great shape right now. King Street, both directions between Central and Marshall in Waterloo. That's still closed off in both directions for long-term construction. You'll find southbound on King Street slow from Central to Bridgeport. Now with the check on the forecast, here's John Wilson.
One mess to the other. Yesterday it was flurries and cold, and tomorrow it'll be freezing rain and not good. But today it's a little bit of a pause. 3 degrees and sunny with increasing cloud tonight, -7. Then there's the problem. Rain coming in tomorrow, falling into -7 air at the ground. That's going to take a long time to get up to zero or above where we can just make it straight rain and not have it freeze into ice. So we could have several hours of freezing rain tomorrow and then eventually rain in 3 late. And then 12, a quick rise and a quick fall Thursday morning, back to zero Friday. Today's high 3.
And right now outside the City News 570 studio, partly sunny, -5, wind chill, -11. Again, a special weather statement in effect for the risk of freezing rain and ice pellets tomorrow morning and into the afternoon. The Trudeau government has now unveiled its new climate plan to reduce emissions before the end of the decade. The documents just released. City News Parliament Hill reporter Cormac McSweeney with more.
This plan includes $9.1 billion in new investments. The government says it reflects economy-wide measures such as carbon pricing and clean fuels, while also targeting actions sector by sector. Now, the investments will go to help reduce energy costs for homes and buildings, make it easier for Canadians to switch to electric vehicles, and help industries develop and adopt clean technology in their journey to net zero emissions. The plan also projects the oil and gas industry will need to cut greenhouse gas emissions by 40% from current levels by 2030 if the country is to meet its targets. They also project that electricity emissions will be almost zero by the end of the decade. Cormac McSweeney, Parliament Hill.
In sports, the Leafs are in Boston tonight, hooking up with the Bruins. Airtime on City News 570 is 7 o'clock. Be the first to know your news your way any time of day. If it's happening in Waterloo Region, you'll find out about it on City News 570 at kitchener.citynews.ca. News next at 11:30. I'm Paul McPhee, City News.
Every day is a new battle, so let's arm you with the information you need to survive this day. This is the Mike Farwell Show, simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570 and Rogers TV. Producer Polly in for Mike Farwell today and tomorrow. Well, there's no doubt that social media has changed in the last few years, and the pandemic seemed to have escalated some of the divisions that we've been seeing online. And this is the basis of a piece that appeared recently in The Conversation by Najmeh Khalili Mahani. And Najmeh joins us now. Najmeh, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
In this piece, you referred to, quote, tribal media. Expand on that a little bit.
Well, I think it's referring very much to the fact that by blocking Donald Trump from the social media, as we understood it before, to be this global unifying force that is allowing us to come together and converse about anything that we want, it sort of realized that, no, there are different stakeholders who cannot have a conversation, you know, a safe conversation with one another. and they have to create their own little social media. And then they would create a social media for the type of conversations that they think they can have or that they should have. So the idea was triggered by the fact that Donald Trump announced the Truth Media. And that was, of course, a reaction to the Twitter sort of blocking his access to the social media permanently.
So when social media first started up, it ended up, you know, a lot of people were, you know, posting pictures of their food or their cat. But it escalated into, you know, divisive conversation. Did you expect that social media was going to become as divisive as it ended up becoming?
Well, I mean, I think that's the law of media. When a medium is pushed to its limits, it's sort of reverting into some of its former types. And this is the argument that I'm making, referring to our dear Marshall McLuhan. I think what happened, social media, it's been around for about 20 years. Somehow, about, I think, 12 years ago, its impact on political movements became very obvious with things such as the Green Revolution in Iran. Something like Facebook was very instrumental in getting the message out. Then there was the Arab Spring. Then we came to COVID, and we were in a situation that people had to converse about these difficult challenges that the pandemic had forced people to discuss. And then we suddenly faced this wall of awareness of what this social media was really about. So on the one hand, these big tech companies, they were caught red-handed by spying on their users, by tailoring the messages to them, by sort of clustering people based on their interests, and then they used the same algorithms to censor the users, right? They use the same algorithms to sort of decide what should or should not be said on this social media. So I think we soon were confronted with the reality that this social media is run by private companies, and it can be censored. It can be censored in Russia, it can be censored in China, and it can be censored in the United States of America. And I think this is why people are using it a little bit differently, in the sense that they are not communicating globally, but they are communicating within their own communities. Now, this could have positive effects if you have a small community, a local community of people getting together to take care of the elderly. Then that's a wonderful tribalization that we can think of. But if it is, you know, the supporters of a specific political movement, then they're going to be in their own resonance box and somehow fragmenting the society more than it is. So media is always a double-edged sword.
When the pandemic began, you took the opportunity to conduct some survey on people's social media habits in 2020, and you revisited it in 2021. What did you find in that research?
So what we found initially was that this was building on a study that we had done before. We had found a very robust association between being stressed, especially emotionally stressed, and using social media. So those who were more stressed, they were more likely to be hooked on social media. And we hypothesized that it's not the social media that is stressing people, but people are using social media to cope with other stressors. We found that The COVID sort of created a condition that it forced a new stress, and then we could measure changes in social media usage with the COVID. And we realized that indeed increased usage of social media was associated with perceived stress of COVID. But we also started noticing that there is a reversal of this trend, that people are disengaging from social media, especially when it was becoming negative, polarized, very politicized. We are sort of going through the analysis of the, we are now into the third year of this survey, just to see how patterns are changing. But the fact that 25% of Facebook's stock market shares have dropped, then it's sort of a testament that people are defecting from this medium and are looking for other ways of connecting.
Now, before social media really became a thing, even before MySpace, in the early days of the internet, we had these, you know, these chat rooms. And it seems that with the pandemic, everybody being moved online, there seems to be more of kind of that sort of model, people, you know, chatting back and forth about things. Is that a good thing that we're kind of reversed back to that chat room model almost?
I think the chat room, from my assessment, the chat room is a necessity of confronting two problems with social media. One is that people are now aware that social media is monitoring the content that they're sharing, and it's monitoring it for two purposes, A, as a surveillance machine, and B, as a marketing machine. To sort of go to the smaller chat rooms is, to some extent, protecting people from the censorship, but it's also protecting them probably from the advertisement. So I think the social media is beginning to shoot itself in the foot by just bombarding its users with advertisement all the time. So you have no opportunity to be connecting to people that you care about. And I think we are reverting to sort of smaller chat rooms so that we are in conversation with people that we know on the topics that we can keep focused on without receiving, you know, 20 advertisements every 30 seconds, I would say. So that's a response. It's an adaptation to what the social media has become. And the idea is that, again, I repeat, when a medium is pushed to its limits, then it's going to be sort of looking back at where it started from. And in fact, Facebook, for instance, it started buying WhatsApp. It is now creating this metaverse in which people would be in virtual rooms and probably seeing each other in 3D instead of in character space. So they are trying to address the issue of the necessity of having face-to-face conversation, I think, after this wave of negativity and lacking nuances in being kind to each other about the issues that the pandemic raised. Probably that's how these technology companies are responding.
So Facebook and Twitter are two of the biggest social media platforms, and we've seen people over the last couple of years ditch Facebook and Twitter, whether it's they feel that their personal information is being sold or whether or not they don't like the fact that maybe some of their posts or certain news stories are being censored. So we're seeing some of these smaller platforms gain a bigger audience. Do you think that trend is going to continue?
My prediction is that the trend is going to continue. I think what we are confronting, at least in our own research, we do have part of the work that I do is to create these specific social networks for research. For instance, I'm interested in studying chronic pain, and I'm aware of the affordances of social media, but I don't want to be using a commercial platform like Facebook. But what we are realizing is that to develop such spaces is very expensive. And actually, most of the workforce who is qualified to do this kind of work is employed by these big tech companies. So there's going to be a shortage of people who can develop these smaller platforms. But I think there is going to be a desire for them. And I think we're going to see more and more of that emerging in the coming years.
And some of these smaller platforms would cater to people who might hold one political view over another, and this could maybe have the effect of creating an echo chamber event, and you're just talking with people who agree with you instead of having real conversations.
Yes. I mean, that's always a challenge, and I think what we saw is that this echo chamber being very large in the pandemic era, the polarization suddenly in North America became so palpable that the tech companies had to take side with, what was presumed to be the more reasonable side and block the other group of people out. But just because social media is blocking them out, it doesn't mean that they do not need to be talking about their issues. So that is a problem. I think this one of the things that we are arguing is that this censorship is going to be hurting in general all of us, because it's creating even further divisions and even further distrust how we are communicating with one another, how our governments are communicating with us. And yes, that is definitely a danger. But on the positive side, I think everybody who is on whatever side of the divide, we are as humans, we are trying to survive and we are trying to do our best to survive. So I think maybe in a smaller community, people would become more creative in coming to the solutions for the problems that we are facing globally. So instead of bickering at each other, we might come together and reach some form of a consensus on what is going to be best for the humanity. And probably that kind of a consensus can be reached better in smaller communication communities than in a big global cacophony of opposing voices.
Has the pandemic made tribalism worse than maybe it otherwise would have been over this two-year period?
Well, we are currently witnessing a nationalist war being fought in Europe, mm-hmm. and we are seeing, we are seeing that something that we didn't think would be conceivable maybe 30 years ago is unfolding before our eyes, and we can see what are the consequences of this type of tribalism. I think the social media is playing a very active role in exacerbating these kind of problems. Maybe in a smaller scale, it would be doing the same. But at the same time, my hope is that to communicate in a smaller group, at least you would be with people that you know, that you would be in direct contact with, and the consequences of your words and actions would be more measurable, so it might have some form of a corrective influence. But whether that is the case or not, I think we'll have to see how human nature is going to adapt to the new media reality.
Najmeh, thank you very much for your time this morning.
Thank you very much.
Najmeh Khalili Mahani is a researcher and director of Media Health Game Clinic Laboratory at Concordia University, and she writes recently in The Conversation about the pandemic making things a little more, as she calls it, tribal media. We've all been pushed online, people working from home. Even here at the office, we've had a voluntary return to the office, and I don't see anybody here. Everybody's still working from home. And when your life is online, you do a lot more chatting and things like that. So very interesting. If you have a comment, of course, always welcome your comments at 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715 and *570. This is the Mike Farwell Show with producer Polly filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
Want to get a word in? Call the Mike Farwell Show now. 519-570-2545. heads. This is the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
I think this is why people are using it a little bit differently, in the sense that they are not communicating globally, but they are communicating within their own communities. Now, this could have positive effects if you have a small community, a local community of people getting together to take care of the elderly. Then that's a wonderful tribalization that we can think of. But if it is, you know, the supporters of a specific political movement, then they're going to be in their own resonance box.
Najmeh Khalili Mahani, researcher, director of health and game clinic laboratory at Concordia University, joining us a few moments ago to talk about this piece titled "The COVID-19 Pandemic Has Pushed Social Media to Become Increasingly Tribal." And the pandemic certainly has not helped that. If you have a comment, 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715 and star 570. Najmeh was talking about some research that she conducted at the beginning of the pandemic on people's social media habits and what that research concluded. They, in March 2020, they polled people and asked them to monitor some of their social media habits. And then they came back in 2021. And what the research found, interestingly, is that when we, with the pandemic, of course, social interactions, in-person interactions are reduced, have been reduced. So we take that social interaction online. And instead of arguing about politics online, which of course some of us are, people tended to gravitate a little bit more towards community, you know, that sense of, you know, at this point in the middle of the pandemic, that was the only way to connect with people. So building community instead of gravitating towards political content or even news stories about the pandemic. So interesting piece. And of course, that website is always interesting, The Conversation. I'm looking at some of the things that are trending on Twitter right now. And in Canada, of the top 10 things trending, like seven of them are to do with the Oscars. Everybody is still talking about that slap heard around the world when Will Smith smacked Chris Rock in the face. And Will Smith has actually apologized in a statement to Chris Rock in the wake of the slap heard around the world. The newly minted Oscar winner assaulted the comedian after he made a joke about Jada Pinkett Smith that she didn't like. Quote, "Violence in all its forms is poisonous and destructive. My behavior at last night's Academy Awards was unacceptable and inexcusable." Goes on to say, "Jokes at my expense are part of the job, but the joke about Jada's medical condition was too much for me to bear, and I reacted emotionally." And, you know, seeing the speaking of online conversation, which is what we've been talking about for the last half hour, people are really divided on this Will Smith, Chris Rock issue. You know, on one hand, people are applauding Will Smith for, you know, standing up for his wife. And on the other hand, people are saying, look, it was only a joke. Should Chris Rock have said it? Probably not. Of course, there's this debate whether Chris Rock even knew that Will Smith's wife had this condition. She's been pretty open about it on social media. And of course, Chris Rock being within the whole Hollywood sphere probably would have known. But if you make a joke like that, is the appropriate response to be slapped in the face? I think it was a bit of an overreaction. I think it would have been a little more appropriate for Will Smith to maybe pull Chris Rock aside during the commercial break and go, hey, man, that wasn't cool. Or even that verbal exchange that they had. If that was the only thing that happened, I think that would have been a little more appropriate. But people are very divided on what happened at the Oscars on Sunday night. Let's go to the news. And then after that, we're talking about Canada's, or actually the world's, food supply chain. And one of my favorite people in the world, Dr. Sylvain Charlebois, professor of food and distribution policy with the Faculty of Management and Agriculture at Dalhousie University, will be joining us in just a few moments. This is the Mike Farwell Show with producer Polly filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
Hold that thought for a moment. We'll return with more of the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570, simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
This hour of the Mike Farwell Show is brought to you by...
Number one for breaking news, traffic, and weather. This is City News 570, everywhere.
It's 11:30, mostly sunny, minus 5, wind chill of minus 11. Good morning, I'm Aaron Anderson with the City News 570 top story. Ontario has unveiled what it's calling a plan to stay open, which aims to ensure the province is better equipped to respond to another health crisis. The government's plan includes boosting the pay of PSWs, recruiting more nurses, and maintaining a stockpile of PPE. Health Minister Christine Elliott says while the COVID-19 pandemic is not over, the province is in a place where it can use the lessons learned over the past 2 years to shore up the health system. Environment Minister Stephen Guilbeault today tabling a new climate plan in Parliament that projects the oil and gas industry will need to cut greenhouse gas emissions by 40% by 2030. Oil and gas accounts for more than one quarter of Canada's total emissions, and the sector's carbon footprint has grown 20% since 2005. Guilbeault is forecasting that electricity emissions will be almost zero by the end of the decade, but notes it will take longer to see progress from the transportation sector, which accounts for 25% of current emissions. It could be a messy day on roadways tomorrow. Environment Canada issuing a special weather statement for Waterloo Region and our surrounding areas. The National Weather Agency says a mix of freezing rain and ice pellets is possible tomorrow morning before switching over to regular rain in the afternoon. It's also not clear how much freezing rain we could see. In sports, it's the Leafs and Bruins tonight on City News. Broadcast time is 7 o'clock. You can follow City News 570 on Twitter at City News KIT. News next at noon. I'm Aaron Anderson, City News.
This show's far from over. Mike still has plenty to say. The Mike Farwell Show's continuing right now on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570 and Rogers TV. Producer Polly in with you today and tomorrow. Mike Farwell is back on Thursday. Well, we're joined now by one of my favorite people He's always interesting. Dr. Sylvain Charlebois is professor of food distribution and policy of the Faculty of Management and Agriculture at Dalhousie University, and writes about the food crisis that we're seeing right now, particularly in relation to the situation in Ukraine and how Canada could possibly help. Dr. Charlebois, thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Now, perhaps some don't realize it, but Ukraine specifically plays a huge role in the world's food supply.
Absolutely. Now, over the last few weeks, we've often labeled Ukraine as the breadbasket of Europe. I would actually go further than that. I think Ukraine is actually the breadbasket of the Middle East, Northeast Africa, and parts of Europe. And of course, with Belarus and Russia, that region is an ag superpower. And so, because of the conflict, of course, there's a lot of uncertainty. We don't know exactly what the output is going to be for this year, and so that's on the grain side, and with fertilizers also, there's mm-hmm. some uncertainty, and farmers around the world, including Canada, will need fertilizers to increase yields. So it's not looking great right now. We're just about to finish the month of March, and farmers are starting to prepare for seeding season without knowing really if they're going to have enough fertilizers and if they'll be able to produce enough grains for this year.
Have the impacts of this situation in Ukraine begun to ripple through the food supply yet, or is that still yet to come?
It's because of prices. Commodity prices are way up. So right now, I would say for grain-based products, suppliers or companies who do procure commodities like wheat, for example, barley, corn, are likely renegotiating contracts right now and have to pay more for the ingredients. So we are expecting prices like bread, for example, in bakery to shift in April right away. And then of course, increases will work their way through the entire grocery store, affecting animal-based products like meat, for example, and eventually dairy. Again, dairy prices are going up right now. But because of the Ukrainian conflict, we could actually see another upward cycle later this year or early in 2023.
And in your note that was sent out yesterday, you mentioned that this effect will first start in African countries. Will we feel the effects here in North America eventually?
I think famine is a definite possibility. In fact, we're starting to see some evidence of that in different parts of the world. I don't think it's going to happen in Canada. We have a robust system here. We do produce a lot of grains in Canada. However, I mean, food affordability is absolutely going to be compromised. We are expecting the food inflation rate to increase even more. In February, it was at 7.4%. I wouldn't be surprised if it exceeds 8% at some point this year. In America, it's already at 8.6%, I believe. So you can see that really people are going to be struggling. And a lot of Canadian families are really have a tight budget right now. So the 8% is certainly not going to help.
Now, the UN's World Food Program is having issues as well, not only because of the Ukrainian situation, but this started with the pandemic.
Absolutely. There's a bit of it's a lingering issue. They were short billions of dollars entering the Ukrainian conflict. Now, the Ukraine itself supplies for almost 10% of the food the program actually needs to in order to operate. So there's, again, the deficit that the World Food Program had just expanded even more as a result of the Ukrainian conflict. And And the reason why I wrote the note is that I wanted to invite Canadians to think differently about global food security, even though famine won't likely be an issue in Canada. Food security is for many families, for sure. It's a reality for a good number of households. But for, as a country, I think we have to think about our responsibility around the world. How we can produce more, and some policies could be revisited. For example, I know that we're committed to the Paris Agreement targets for gas emissions. It is really hampering farmers right now. They have to spend more money to produce the same amount of food. That's putting a lot of pressure on them. Taxes they have to pay on fertilizers and things like that. It can actually impact cash flow for many of these operations. Those are some of the things that we need to think about. Also, over the long term, Canada actually has a scheme called Canpotex.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. Yeah.
Canpotex.
A lot of people don't know about this, but I would say 99% of your listeners wouldn't even know that Canpotex exists. But Canpotex is a company based out of Saskatchewan, gives billions of dollars to the Saskatchewan government, but it is a bit of a cartel. It represents two major companies, Mosaic and Nutrien, and its role is to actually export fertilizer to the rest of the world at the best price possible. In other words, Canpotex actually makes fertilizers more expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the last thing we need right now, expensive fertilizers.
What can Canada do right now to help farmers in the very short term?
So very short term, like right now, I think looking at the fiscal nature of ag businesses, providing some relief to farmers would help, absolutely. And I think that Alberta is looking into it right now, and I believe also Saskatchewan. So those are things we can do like right now. Over the longer term, of course, I think someone will have to look. We'll have to give a second look to the Canpotex business model. I'm just not convinced it's the way to go to grow the industry. There are two major mines being developed right now in Saskatchewan, K&S and BHP. Both of them are out of scope. They're not included in Canpotex. Why? Because the Saskatchewan government knows for a fact that Canpotex has some issues. I mean, moral issues, absolutely. So as you can see that really there's some movement there, but it's not happening fast enough, unfortunately. And this year we're going to have to really be dealing with some major deficits with commodities.
Is North America, and more specifically Canada, are we equipped to at least make up some of the shortfall in the world's food supply because of the Ukrainian situation? Can we do it?
I think we need to be more efficient. I mean, there's most farmers out there will tell you, "Well, I can't grow more." I would beg to differ. I actually think that everyone can grow more. And there's been some investments in precision agriculture. Agriculture in general in Canada is becoming much more efficient. But more can be done with the utilization of better technologies, using fertilizers wisely, not spreading everything all equally. That's a waste. And farmers are getting smarter. And of course, with fuel charges, you're seeing more and more driverless tractors out there. I'm in the U.S. right now, and I met a farmer who was able to drive four tractors at once at the same time.
Wow.
Yeah, four combines all at once at the same time. Nobody's in them. Incredible. Yeah, so a lot of things can happen to make our farms more efficient, to grow more with less.
And now planting season is right about now, so I guess this invasion of Ukraine could not have happened at a worse time, at least with the world's food supply. Is that right?
If President Putin wanted to disrupt the ag world the best he could with the invasion, he picked the right time for sure. Now, the wild card in all this is China. What is China going to do? Is China going to buy Russian wheat? Is it going to buy commodities? Because China doesn't necessarily buy just for China, by the way. It buys and sells. So it'll be interesting to see exactly what China intends to do. Now, we've heard some good news from India and Australia in recent days. They are increasing exports, which is good. Less pressure on North American farmers. But again, Mother Nature has to cooperate, and we saw what happened last year. We're actually going into 2022 with little or no inventory because last year's drought was devastating. Mm-hmm. So let's hope that Mother Nature cooperates this year.
Dr. Shali Bhatt, thanks for joining us today.
All right, take care. Bye-bye.
Dr. Sylvain Charlebois, of course, you know him as a professor of food distribution and policy in the Faculty of Management and Agriculture at Dalhousie University. Yeah, one of the things he was saying, that it really is, farming is more high-tech than you think it is. A lot of these tractors have GPS units in them now. And that really, you have these self-driving tractors, as Dr. Charlebois was just saying there. And with GPS units, you can keep right on track and know exactly where you've plowed. It really is interesting. And even for the tractors that have people driving them still, you have your whole farm all mapped out on a GPS, and you can pick up the next morning exactly where you left off. So really interesting stuff. If you have a comment, of course, we always like to take your calls here on the Mike Farwell Show with producer Polly filling in. 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715 and star 570. That's what Kyle has done today. Star 570. Go ahead, Kyle.
Always hands free, my friend. Always hands free, you know?
Yep.
What's Mr. Biden going to do? Like, President Biden's there. Like, you know, here we go. We're going into, obviously, there's a war happening in Europe, and mm-hmm. the prices have gone skyrocketing, right? But, I mean, Canada, look at our prices for fuel. I'm spending, oh my gosh, I'm spending $7,000 to $10,000 a week in fuel alone.
A week? Right? Now, this is, like, you have a number of vehicles out there, right, Kyle?
Yeah, I've got
this is like your whole fleet.
Three semi trucks out there, and yeah, like where do you think that money gets passed on to the consumer?
Of course,
right. So I mean, I can't go and lower that, you know, and help that out, right? Like we're supposed to all help each other out, but you know, if you got grocery stores and obviously, you know, like the what's going on with the wheat prices and the commodities going up and down and stuff, mm-hmm. you know, that's really going to affect. Like the way, like he said, that be like chicken and, or what do you say, meat prices are going up.
Everything's going up, yeah.
I've talked to farmers and they said, you know, chicken prices could be doubling by next year. Doubling.
Oh, yeah. Imagine,
you know, going in and paying double the price that you pay now, but your wages and your salaries and all that stuff isn't going up.
Mm-hmm.
So this is going to be, I think, you know what, I'm not trying to be a negative Nancy here, but I think the next few years is going to be very tough for all of us.
Yeah, like, it could
very
be.
Very hard, right?
Yeah.
So, stick together and just, you know, we'll get through it, right? Yeah. We did it for the last 2 years.
That's
you know?
Right. Yeah, that's there's a silver lining there. Thanks, Kyle. The supply chain is an interesting thing. Most of us don't stop to think about it. You think about the farmer planting the wheat, but then you got to harvest it and turn it into something else. Then there's, you know, some of it might get turned into muffins, and so what's all the supply chain issue involved in making sure that the oven is created with the melting down of the metal and the heating elements? It's really amazing when you think about it. Just to make something simple as a muffin, the supply chain is crazy, and none of us really stop to think about it. But the world is a lot more complicated sometimes than we believe. So yeah, the price of everything is going up. Food and gasoline, and certainly the Ukrainian situation is not helping with any of that, but is certainly not the only cause of it. Mm-hmm. Kathy, go ahead.
Well, good morning.
The agricultural aspect of this is always very interesting. This has been going on for quite some time, problems with prices going up for farmers, and it's just escalated tremendously to the point that it's becoming evident to the urban consumer. So it has been a problem. It's just really gotten a whole lot worse.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to hear you talk to some of the farming people on this, the Grain Producers Association, the cattlemen's, to find out from the farmer's point of view exactly how they are feeling about this. I live in a rural community, and a lot of farmers are considering whether it's even worthwhile to put a crop in the ground because the input costs are so much. The uncertainty with the weather and the crop they're going to get, are we going to do it or not?
Mm-hmm.
That's something that needs to be talked about, I think. And there needs to be some, like the professor mentioned about some government regulations and changes to help farmers out. There's no doubt about that. And I'd like to see some of the other, the actual on-the-ground conversation going on here to give you a better understanding of everything.
That's not a bad idea, Kathy. I'm actually looking for content for tomorrow's show. Maybe I will reach out.
Yeah, I think that would be a good idea. And as far as the average consumer is concerned, like, what can you do? And I'll tell you what I do. I grew up on a farm.
Mm-hmm.
I have a country property. I have the space. I grow my own vegetables. And I freeze and produce my own food.
Mm-hmm.
More people could do this. Not everybody can. But what I will do is, like, I will add certain things there so that when stuff that is beyond my control goes up in price, I am saving money on another end, and I try to juggle things as best I can. Not everybody can do that, mm-hmm. but they're talking a lot about community gardens. We're getting into the gardening season,
yep.
getting more people involved. That would help some.
Yeah, I like that idea, Kathy. Thanks a lot for the call.
Okay, bye.
Yeah, even at our house, we have a small garden in our backyard, and my wife will sometimes, you know, make tomatoes or basil. She likes growing her own basil, but that could be a solution as well. Maybe grow some of our own food. Of course, not all of us have the opportunity to do that. Maybe you live in an apartment or something and you don't have any land to do that, but not a bad idea. And planting season is here, so maybe I got to talk to my wife about that. Tonight's the perfect opportunity to do so. This is the Mike Farwell Show with producer Paulie filling in on City News 570 and Rogers Television.
We know you have an opinion, so call the Mike Farwell Show, 519-570-2545, or toll free, 1-800-570-5715, and star 570. We're back with more local talk. This is the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
We've often labeled Ukraine as the breadbasket of Europe. I would actually go further than that. I think Ukraine is actually the breadbasket of the Middle East, Northeast Africa, and parts of Europe. And of course, with Belarus and Russia, that region is an ag superpower. And so, because of the conflict, of course, there's a lot of uncertainty. We don't know exactly what the output is going to be for this year.
Dr. Sylvain Charlebois, professor of food distribution and policy with the Faculty of Management and Agriculture at Dalhousie University, joining us to discuss the food crisis that we're seeing a little bit right now, due a lot to the situation between Russia and Ukraine. Ukraine, for decades, going back even hundreds of years, has been known as the breadbasket of Europe, and Dr. Charlebois saying, really, it is the breadbasket of the world. The land there is very fertile, and you can plant almost anything there, it seems. And they provide, Ukraine provides, was it 9% of the world's wheat? And then I was seeing online last week, I think, 15% of the calories consumed via wheat, I believe, something along those lines. But you know, Canada could help if we're willing to help. Now, unfortunately, Dr. Charlebois was saying that, you know, you might have to cut back on some of our, you know, Canada's emissions targets, because that might help increase the food situation. So people who are concerned about that sort of thing certainly would not be happy, but I don't know what the solution is here. It's sometimes tough to, you know, come up with a solution that's suitable to everybody. But another great show I really enjoy hosting. At 9:30, we talked about this deal that Ontario has just reached for $10 a day for childcare. And Ontario was the last province to ink a deal with the federal government, and that will be in place, according to Stephen Lechier, who joined us. That will be in place fairly quickly. We're looking at the fall, but depending on how things work, we may be seeing rebates for parents in the fall, retroactive to April or May of this year. So Stephen Lechier, Minister of Education, joined us at 9:30 to talk about that. At 10 o'clock, we talk about the Sunshine List. More than 9,300 Waterloo Region public sector workers made $100,000 a year on the Sunshine List. And in the whole province, 244,000 people were on the list, compared to 205,000 in 2020. And people are asking whether this should be indexed to inflation. One of my arguments is, if you did index it to inflation, the list would still grow. It grew by 19% last year. That's beyond the inflation rate, for sure. And at 10:30, talked about stroll walking tours. That sounds really exciting. Walking tours of Kitchener-Waterloo, strollwalkingtours.com. And at 11, how the COVID-19 pandemic has pushed social media to become increasingly tribal. I'm back tomorrow hosting for Mike Farwell. This has been the Mike Farwell Show with me, producer Polly, on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
CKGLAM Kitchener, broadcasting live from the boardwalk. Breaking news, traffic, and weather. When you need to know, keep it on City News 570.
This hour of the Mike Farwell.
Perth, Brantford Grant, Guelph Wellington, and the Waterloo Region. Hyperlocal stories that matter to you and your community. All this and more on your Region This Week. All local, all year round. New episodes every Friday at 7 p.m. right here on Rogers TV.
Are you interested in learning TV production? Have you ever wanted your own TV show? There's an opportunity waiting for you at Rogers TV. On Friday, April 8th, visit us on location at the Sleeman Center and find out how you can get involved with Rogers TV. From working on our OHL broadcasts and daily shows to pitching and producing your own show, discover how you can be part of community TV. Details at RogersTV.com.
This is Rogers TV.